What's going on, all my healthcare brothers and sisters? I hope that you are having a wonderful day. Here at Nurse Cheung, it is our goal to help you pass your NCLEX and your nursing exams like a boss. We've been discussing arterial blood gases and how they affect our system, and today we're going to be diving deeper into respiratory acidosis. Let's get our nurse on. So when it comes to respiratory acidosis, it really is the total concentration of buffer base being less than normal, with a relative increase in hydrogen ion concentration, thus a greater number of hydrogen ions is circulating in the blood that can be absorbed by the buffer system. So we know that our hydrogen ions are the more acidic part of our acid-base balance system. So if we've got a low pH, because we know with our pH it's going to get lower when it's more acidic, and a high PaCO2, we're going to have a respiratory acidosis. So the respiratory system breathes off carbon dioxide. If the lungs are unable to excrete that excess of carbon dioxide, then that carbon dioxide is going to start building up inside the body. So when you have a patient maybe post-surgical that has come to your floor and they've got a big respiratory depression, either because of too much narcotics or too much anesthesia drugs during the procedure, then they're going to have respiratory depression. The more depressed that respiratory system is, they're unable to breathe off that carbon dioxide, making it build up inside the system, leading to respiratory acidosis. So that's just one example of what you might see in respiratory acidosis. A good memory trick to help you remember this for your exams is that respiratory rate is slow. We're having respiratory depression, our respiratory rate is slow, and acidosis. So I hope that helps you when you're doing your exams to try to figure out what the cause is, and what you might see dependent on that cause. So as we talked about before, you're going to have retention of CO2 when it comes to respiratory acidosis. So we're looking for some type of respiratory cause, and there's quite a few that can happen. You could have hypoventilation, like we talked about with our post-surgical patient. That's where the respiratory acidosis is caused by the primary defects of the functions of the lungs or changes in that normal respiratory pattern. So you're going to see a decreased respiratory rate or shallow breathing. And it's really seen a lot, like I said, with our post-surgical patients as well as opiate overdoses. We have to be very careful when working on a surgical unit, specifically me, coming from an open heart ICU background. You have to really be careful with these patients because they can go bad very quickly depending on how much anesthesia or opioids are within their system. You can also have airway obstruction. So any condition that causes an obstruction of the airway leading to hypoventilation or depresses that respiratory system can cause respiratory acidosis. So this is really seen when it comes to our asthma patients, potentially even like aspiration patients if they're unable to swallow and they aspirate. COPD, bronchitis, and pneumonia patients are at increased risk of developing respiratory acidosis. And lastly, lung collapse. If we have a pneumothorax or any kind of atelectasis taking place, especially like with our acute respiratory distress syndrome patients, where we have this massive fluid buildup in the lungs and it ultimately collapses those alveolar sacs because of all of that fluid buildup affecting their surfactant component within our lungs, you can see respiratory acidosis with those patients. Additional causes could be sleep apnea, head trauma, excessive pressure on the respiratory center or the medulla oblongata depresses those respirations, can also lead to this. Central nervous system depressants. This is a huge NCLEX tip. So you're going to see this on the NCLEX. So any kind of depressants such as sedatives, opioids, anesthetics, like with our post-surgical patients, can lead to hypoventilation and may require reversal agents depending on what the underlying cause is. So you can have an opioid overdose, alcohol intoxication. You're going to see that a lot with our CWA patients. Again, I did a video on that. If you're more interested in what's happening with alcohol withdrawal and intoxication with our CWA patients, make sure that you check that video out. It's going to be extremely helpful in your studies, as well as benzodiazepines. Benzodiazepines tend to cause systemic central nervous system depression. So it's highly, highly recommended that you monitor patients that are on these particular depressants to make sure that they are not hypoventilating, causing retention of CO2 leading to respiratory acidosis. And lastly, like I had talked about before, with that atelectasis, you're going to have impaired gas exchange. And you see that a lot when it comes to acute respiratory distress syndrome, also known as ARDS, because we're unable to pass those gases back and forth like our lungs normally would, because of all that fluid buildup. It kind of blocks the oxygen from being able to come down and attach to the hemoglobin. Initially, the CO2 will get through that oxygen, but will get through that fluid, but eventually you're going to see, because of the fluid accumulation, it's unable to completely get through, you're going to see that retention of CO2 with our acute respiratory distress syndrome patients. So that it is highly recommended that you monitor them very closely because they can go bad very quickly. So let's talk about what our patient is going to look like, what they are going to present with. So it's important to monitor the patient's level of consciousness, use protective measures to ensure their safety, monitor electrolyte levels, as well as follow up on ABG test results when it comes to our respiratory acidosis patients. So neurologically, your neurological system is extremely sensitive to changes in pH levels as well as oxygenation. So if you have any kind of change take place with those two components, you're going to see lethargy, confusion, the patient might be restless, dizziness, headache, and coma. So you're going to see specifically, say you have grandma, this is just an example. You have grandma and you take care of her the day before and she loves you. She wants to introduce you to her grandchild because she just knows that you are going to be the best fit for her grandchild. And the next day you come in and she hates your guts. She can't sit still. She's just kind of all over the place. I mean, those are the beginning changes of respiratory acidosis. Those are those early things that we can catch to know that something is happening and something is wrong with these patients. Cardiovascular-wise, you're going to have a decrease in your blood pressure, dysrhythmias related to hyperkalemia from that compensation. So like we talked about in our previous videos, potassium plays a huge role when it comes to compensation. So if you've got a buildup of hydrogen ions, of all of that acid, it's the body is going to push those hydrogen ions inside the cells to try to get rid of them. But potassium and hydrogen ions have an inverse relationship. So if hydrogen ions are going into the cell, potassium has got to come out. So you're going to have a higher serum potassium than you would normally when it comes to an acidotic state patient. So you're going to see dysrhythmias because of that increase in serum potassium, the hyperkalemia. And lastly, you're going to have warm, flushed skin, particularly related to peripheral vasodilation. So when it comes to the gastrointestinal system, you're not going to really see a whole bunch of significant changes. You could potentially see vomiting. It's really not as common in respiratory acidosis, but you could potentially see it. Neuromuscular-wise, seizures is a huge one. We talked about the brain has a very low tolerance when it comes to pH and oxygenation changes. So you could start to see seizures taking place, as well as muscle weakness due to that hyperkalemia because of that hydrogen ion exchange with inside the cells. And then lastly, the respiratory system. This is respiratory acidosis, so you're going to see a change, right? So the respiratory rate and depth is going to increase in an attempt to exhale those acids, right? Our respiratory component works very quickly within minutes, 10 to 30 minutes, and wants to get that acid out. So it's going to attempt to try to do that very quickly. However, where there is a respiratory problem, lungs really aren't able to compensate for the respiratory issue that's taking place. So you're going to see that hypoventilation and hypoxia start to occur in these patients, and they can't go down very quickly if it's not addressed. So what is medical management going to look like for respiratory acidosis patients? Well, the big thing is we want to fix the underlying cause. You can do a whole bunch of interventions, but if you don't fix that underlying cause, it's really not going to make a whole lot of difference. So to begin with, we always want to protect our airway and maintain it as best as we can. So we want to monitor for signs of respiratory distress. We're going to administer oxygen if needed. If they're losing oxygen, we want to make sure we're getting that in there. We want to encourage and assist the patient to turn, cough, and deep breathe. That's going to be huge on exhaling all of that acid, right? We're going to encourage hydration to thin out secretions if that is a potential cause. And we're also going to give bronchodilators. Could be very helpful depending if we've got any kind of airway obstruction or something taking place. We also want to improve ventilation. So we want to avoid sedatives and opioids because these medications can further cause respiratory acidosis because of their respiratory depression side effects. So we have to be very careful with the amount of medications that we're giving them. We can also suction the patient's airway if needed, if there's any kind of obstruction. We can use NIPPV, such as like BiPAP and CPAP as necessary in order to pull off that oxygen, or I'm sorry, that carbon dioxide and get that oxygen in, dependent on if it is a respiratory malfunction syndrome. So sometimes the patients are going to tire out very quickly because they're trying so hard to breathe off all of that carbon dioxide and they might need a little bit of help. So we might have to throw them usually on a BiPAP machine, depending on how severe that respiratory acidosis is. And lastly, if all else fails, we prepare for endotracheal intubation and mechanical ventilation if the CO2 levels rise above 50 millimeters of mercury and they have signs of acute respiratory distress is present. So with our COPD patients, like we had talked about before, you know, they're going to have increased levels of carbon dioxide. So they could have a 50 carbon dioxide, that's their base. We don't want to start throwing people on ventilators because once they're on a ventilator, sometimes depending on what their underlying comorbidities are, like with COPD, it's a lot harder to get them off. You also don't want to overly correct a CO2 of greater than 50 with certain patients because then you actually cause more problems than harm. If their baseline is always 50 and then we get them to 40 because that's normal, it's not good for the patient. Their body's not going to be able to compensate for that, and the body's going to go, hey, where's all my carbon dioxide? I need it. So again, you can actually cause more harm than good depending on what's happening comorbidity-wise with our patient. So we have to always fix the underlying cause, but if the underlying cause is normal, then we don't fix that, if that makes sense. We always want to make sure that we have some acute respiratory distress taking place. If you do have a COPD patient and they are in respiratory distress, obviously we're going to fix that. I hope that helps clear that up a little bit. And lastly, we're going to reverse drug overdoses. So if it is a opioid overdose or alcohol intoxication or whatever the case may be, we're going to give those anecdotal things. If it is a benzodiazepine, we're going to give rimazicon. If it's some kind of opioid, we're going to give Narcan. If it's an alcohol intoxication issue, we can give them fluids, dialysis. There's a bunch of different things that we can give dependent on what the underlying cause is. I hope that this video was helpful in helping pass your arterial blood gas nursing school exams as well as your NCLEX like a boss. If you haven't done so already, make sure that you subscribe here to my YouTube and hit that notification bell so that way you're informed every time I post a new video. You can also follow me on my social media. I am on Facebook and Instagram, and make sure that you check out my website at www.nursecheung.com. There I'm going to have NCLEX style questions, resources, handouts, everything you need to pass those exams like a boss. But until next time, I hope that you're having a wonderful day, and I will see you all again soon. Bye.